Well, hello everyone and good afternoon. Thank you. Good afternoon for everyone accompanying us here at the Schiller Madrid campus, and greetings for everyone connecting from afar. Welcome to Schiller International University. I want to extend a warm welcome to our very special guest today, Neil West. He's a digital content specialist and former head of music at iTunes Europe, iTunes UK, a country manager for Apple in Madrid, Spain. And today he's here. He's going to talk us through how he personally worked very close to Steve Jobs on how iTunes reinvented the music industry. And he's going to give us his 12 main takeaways on how they did this, how Apple really managed to turn a business that was not in the best moment. So for all of you who is the first time that knows us, Schiller International University, I just want to do a very brief introduction. Of course, come on in. We're having more guests here. So we were the very first American university established in Europe in 1964. Today, we still keep pushing the boundaries of innovation. So our mission, our educational mission, is to transform students, both personally and professionally, into global citizens able to work anywhere in an international setting. And we have four campuses in Madrid, Paris, Heidelberg, and Tampa. Our students really learn with experiential methodologies, learning by living. They work in projects. They have close contact with industry experts like Neil and others. And when they finish, after studying in a global business, international relation, or STEM program, they end up with an American, European as well degree if they want, but what they finish with is a global mentality. They're curious, innovative, critical thinkers, committed, responsible leaders. They're really able to work anywhere. So I invite you all to continue knowing about Schiller in our website. And without much else to say, I hand the floor to Neil. Thank you, Neil, again. I hope you all are as excited as we are to listen to what he has to tell us. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Carmen. And thank you, everybody, for coming today. My name is Neil West. Do we have a slide? Oh, you don't need him. This is me. I've spent the last 25 years working in content business, transformation, and digital music, including the last 16 years at Apple. I was head of music for Apple in the UK and then Europe 10 years, and I spent the last 6 years services for Apple Southern Europe based out of Madrid. But we're here today to talk about iTunes and how Apple reinvented the music business. So why iTunes? iTunes is important for a few reasons. Firstly, it's one of Apple's great success stories. The iTunes Music Store was the world's first digital transformation of a major content business. When it launched in 2003, 99.9% of revenues were coming from physical media, LPs, CDs, cassettes. And within 7 years, it had grown to be the world's biggest music store. And it was super important for Apple because this was Apple's pivot into content and services. Services is now the second biggest profit driver after iPhone, and it's the fastest growing. It's also a great story because it's a great case study of Apple's values and the genius of Steve Jobs. So let's take a look. I've got to work out where everything is. Okay, so this afternoon, I'm going to give you a brief history of Apple in 27 pictures and 2 videos. Try and make it easy. We're then going to look at the music business again, and we're going to see why they were in so much trouble. We're then going to look at the launch of iTunes, and you're going to see a bit of Steve Jobs in action. And then I'm going to take you through 12, if you like, leadership lessons or 12 key decisions that really helped iTunes achieve what it did. So let's get started. A brief history of Apple. Apple was founded on the April 1st, 1976 by 21-year-old Steve Jobs and 26-year-old Steve Wozniak, known as Woz. There was a third partner, a guy called Ronald Wayne. Within 2 weeks, he got cold feet and he sold his 10% back to the two Steves. If he'd kept it, it would be worth $250 billion. But hey, sorry, Ronald. And this was the first product. This is the Apple One. No keyboard, no screen, not even a case. They only sold about 200 of them, but it offered revolutionary computing power for the price. It created a big buzz around Silicon Valley. Steve Jobs was able to get venture funding, Woz quit his day job at Hewlett-Packard. And then the next year came this, the Apple II. This is one of the very first computers that really kickstarted the home computer revolution. Apple had to take out advertisements in mainstream magazines and newspapers to explain to people why they might want a home computer. And sales boomed. So much so that in 1980, Apple went public. It raised more money on its IPO than any other IPO in American history since the Ford Motor Company. And by the end of the first day of trading, Steve Jobs, Steve Wozniak, and 300 employees and investors were millionaires. But that sort of success attracts attention and it attracts competition, and IBM, the big of the American computing industry, saw that home computers might be something they wanted to get involved with. And so they entered the market with what's now become a personal computer. They did something slightly different to Apple. They allowed companies to make pretty much clones of machines. It didn't quite allow it. The other companies worked out they could do it. Either way, the point is that with IBM making these machines and lots of other people making identical machines, market share grew, which means Apple's market share started to fall. Steve Jobs needed help. So he hired this guy. This guy's called John Sculley. He came from the Pepsi company, where he'd gone up against Coca-Cola and stolen market share. And Steve figured, well, if he can do that for Pepsi, maybe he can do that for me with IBM. Steve Jobs famously challenged him when trying to court him. He said, do you want to sell sugared water for the rest of your life, or do you want to come with me and change the world? And Steve was he was a great salesman, huh? John Sculley said yes. He joined as Apple's CEO. And relieved of running the company, it meant that Steve Jobs could devote all his attention to Apple's next computer, which was going to be called the Macintosh. And then in January of 1984, American viewers watching the Super Bowl saw this TV commercial.
See why 1984 won't be like 1984.
I don't know. Maybe it hasn't dated so well. But at the time, no one had seen a commercial like it. It was revolutionary. It was so revolutionary, it was replayed on news channels multiple times as news over and over and over. It was directed by Ridley Scott, who you may know went on to, who had directed Blade Runner, and would go on to direct Gladiator. And it was the work of LA advertising agency Chiat Day, and you'll be hearing more of them later on. The New York Times called it the greatest television commercial ever made. And it meant that this machine, the Macintosh, launched with maximum publicity. Mac was Steve's baby. It was revolutionary in offering a graphical user interface, which scores 10 out of 10 for technology, and it was very cute, but the graphical user interface meant that a lot of the third-party software makers really struggled to make their applications for the Mac platform. It was expensive because it spent a lot of money making lots about it that was really cool. It meant that the processors weren't as powerful as the IBM PCs. So, wonderful product, great press, but it struggled to gain market share. That caused a division amongst Apple. Scully, Woz, many others said, Steve, let's do what IBM are doing. Let's make other people make Macintosh computers. We can grow our market share that way. Steve refused. There was an argument. In the end, the board of directors sided against Steve Jobs. They stripped him of operational control of Macintosh, and he resigned. In September 1985, Steve Jobs was out of Apple. He sold all but one of his Apple shares for $70 million. He started another company called Next. Guess what? They make computer and software. But this one's designed for high-end business and education. He also spent what turned out to be a very smart $5 million buying this little computer animation company that no one had ever heard of called Pixar. And Apple continued without him. They did allow clones. Some people said that the license fee that they got from allowing other people to make Macs was a good source of income. Other people said, well, hang on a minute. No, they're cannibalizing our own sales. We could be, these are our sales they're stealing. Either way, they didn't look very pretty. They did have some success. This is the very first Mac laptop. It's called the PowerBook. But they also had some disasters. This thing here is called the Newton. It was the world's first portable digital assistant. Some people loved it. But in many ways, it embodied everything that was wrong with Apple at this time. It was innovative technology, worshipped by a diehard fan base, but it was expensive, it was glitchy, and it just couldn't find mass market. There was another problem. Windows from Microsoft. Windows 3.0, given the PC, its own graphical user interface that was almost as good as the Mac's. Apple needed to upgrade, stay one step ahead. They hadn't done it. They hadn't put in the work. What were they going to do? Guess what? They bought Next. And the Next operating system became the foundation of Mac OS X. And guess who came with the deal? That's right. Steve Jobs was back. In a very short space of time, he was CEO of Apple once again. And he went to work. He cut all of the Apple products. He cut all the clones bar just four. He said, moving forward, we're going to make two computers and we're going to make two portable devices. He put all his energies into the successor to Macintosh. And to reintroduce Apple to the world, he asked Chiat Day to come up with another another advertising campaign. And this is what they did.
Here's to the crazy ones, the misfits, the rebels, the troublemakers, the round pegs in the square holes, the ones who see things differently. They're not fond of rules, and they have no respect for the status quo. You can quote them, disagree with them, glorify or vilify them. About the only thing you can't do is ignore them. Because they change things. They push the human race forward. While some may see them as the crazy ones, we see genius. Because the people who are crazy enough to think they can change the world are the ones who do.
It came in a whole range of beautiful different colors. It was the first Apple product designed by Johnny Ive. who you may know, went on to design most of Apple's most important products over the last couple of decades. And it really was, again, Steve's baby. And really, I think now you can say the dream that he had in his parents' garage all the way back in 1976, a personal computer for everybody, had finally come true. Apple was saved. And we're now entering what many people consider the sort of real golden era of Apple, certainly in the second Steve Jobs stage. And he was just getting started. In 2001, he opened the first Apple store. And, you know, on another day, I could spend hours just talking about how the Apple store revolutionized the way we all buy technology and really turbocharged Apple's growth. But that's for another day. But let's go back to iMac. In 2001, they launched a new range and some beautiful stuff that also had a writable CD drive. Now, this was important. Customers were invited to rip, mix, and burn. What does that mean? It means you put a CD into the CD drive, you rip the songs off it, and you create digital music files. You can then mix those song files to make your own playlist, and then you can burn a CD that you can take with you to play in your car, play on your home stereo, whatever it might be. And then came this. Arguably, the most transformational product in Apple's history. Now, obviously, I'm not forgetting iPhone. This was huge. iPod's offer was simple, 1,000 songs in your pocket. All those songs that you'd ripped from your CDs, now you could take them with you. iPod's potential was so big that it caused a huge pivot for Apple. He released a version of iPod for Windows. Previously, everything Apple had done was within the walled garden, right? You ran it on a Mac, you used Apple peripherals with that, everything was controlled. A few years ago, this would have seemed like sacrilege, but the potential of this product was just too big to ignore. And when available for Mac and Windows, soon this was contributing. iPod alone was over 40% of all Apple revenues. So, 2003, a music player is the world's biggest, hottest consumer electronics product. But the music business itself, these are CDs. Now I'm looking at a lot of people in this room, and I think a lot of the people joining us online, they might not have ever used a CD, but trust me, in the 1990s, these were a big deal, right? 1990s was the age of the CD, and it was a golden age for the record business. The record business, the music business, the record labels. Well, let's talk about the consumers first. Consumers, why did consumers love CDs? Audio quality, so much better than anything that had come before. Durability, they last forever. So we thought, right? And guess what? You can skip songs. How about that, kids? Right? This was revolutionary. The record labels loved CDs because they were cheap to make. They could be sold at premium prices. And people were not just buying new albums on CD. They were buying all the albums that they already owned, again, and upgrading their entire collection. This shows you what the sales of recorded music in the USA, going from 1977 up to the year 2000. This is an all-time high of 20 billion. They've never got back to that. That's still the all-time high. And you can see that it's compact discs that are doing it, right? But then something happened. This happened. Does anyone know what that was? Does anyone know what caused that? Ooh, no, it wasn't the iPod. That's a very contentious argument. No, the real villain here is Napster, right? So what was Napster? Napster was a peer-to-peer file sharing application that you ran on your computer. when you booted up Napster and logged on, you could network of all the other you joined a network of all the other Napster users. You could take song files from their music library, and they could take song files from your music library. It started on college campuses. It grew. To give you a sense of scale, in the year 2000, US 900. All of a sudden, CDs don't look so clever, do they? Right? Napster, instant gratification. Search, download. You don't have to drive to the record store. You don't have to wait for a CD to be delivered through the mail. Limited choice. Even the biggest record store, they can sell out of the stuff that you might want, right? They've got limited shelf space. Napster had everything. After years of people having to buy an album, possibly only wanting one or two songs, with Napster, you just get the songs you want. And the best bit, price, right? It was free, right? Shit, right? Here's just one magazine cover from the time, right? Game over for the music business. I mean, let's just pause and look what happened, right? A huge physical business had been disrupted by a new digital business. Atoms replaced by bits, right? And the implications were huge. Many music fans all over the world delighted in all of a sudden being able to get any song they wanted for free, right? And who can blame them? But for the music business, for the record labels, and let's not forget, they're the ones that pay artists to do what they do. This was a disaster. So, anyone got any solutions? The record labels got together and they did a PR campaign suggesting that people get their music from authorized sources, right? And that immediately solved the whole problem. No, it didn't. To sport back, here's Lars Ulrich from Metallica taking Napster to court for infringing copyright. He didn't succeed. But eventually, Napster was shut down. Under a barrage of lawsuits from all different sides, they were shut down. But the genie had already left the bottle, right? The cat was out of the bag, the horse has bolted the stable. Hundreds of harder-to-kill copycats sprang up in place. Piracy was not going to go away, right? Piracy was not going to go away. The music labels, the record labels, they got together and they said, okay, we can do this. We're going to launch our own legal versions, right? If customers want to get their music online, we'll provide them a legal service. They launched Press Play and MusicNet. Both services were difficult to use, difficult to navigate. In today's money, they cost $25 a month. And they came with some really strange restrictions. Customers were allowed only 500 low-quality audio streams. They could download 50 songs, which expired after 30 days. You could only burn 10 songs to a CD. Not every song could be downloaded. You could not burn more than 2 songs from the same artist to a CD. And you couldn't put any of your songs on a portable music player, right? So you can't put any of them on iPod or any of the others, right? And the best bit, and the worst bit, but the best bit, they couldn't agree. So the music from 2 of the record labels was on this service, and the music from the other 3 was on this one, right? So if you wanted to listen to the top 10, you had to subscribe to both, right? PC World would later list these two products together as the 9th worst tech product of all time, right? Meanwhile, CD sales continue to plummet, right? The music business needs to... So, iTunes. April 2003, we're going to join Steve Jobs on stage at one of Apple's presentations. He's unveiled the third generation of iPods, and he's demonstrating a new version of the iTunes software that manages Mac's music collection and then transfers those songs to iPod. I'm going to let Steve do the work.
Which brings us to acquire. Now, we acquire our music off CDs, right? We go down and buy a CD and we rip it. But we all know that starting in 1999, there was this phenomenon called Napster. It was shut down in 2001, but it demonstrated some things for us. It demonstrated that the internet was made for music delivery. And its offspring, Kazaa, is alive and well today, distributing lots of tracks. Now, there's a good side and a bad side of this. The good side is it offers users near instant gratification, at least as compared to going down to the record store, and again, shows that the internet was built for music delivery. But the downside is it's stealing. It is stealing. So, from a user's point of view, let's look at the upsides and the downsides of this. From a user's point of view. First thing is, it's got a vast selection, better than any record store on the planet. Unlimited CD burning. Unlimited MP3 player. You can put the music on any number of them you want. You can put the music on an unlimited number of computers. And from a user's point of view, it's free. What's wrong with this? Right? It's fantastic. But there's a dark side to it. Very unreliable downloads. Very unreliable quality. A lot of the songs are encoded by 7-year-olds and they don't do a great job. There are no previews, so you can spend a whole lot of time downloading a song and find out it's not exactly the one you wanted. No album cover art. And worst of all, it's stealing. It's best not to mess with karma. So, most people don't focus on these things, though. They focus on the good things. You can say, well, why has this proliferated? Well, because there's no legal alternative. There's no legal alternative that's worth these. We decided, since no one else was doing this, that we were going to do it. And we started about a year and a half ago to create a music store. Music downloads done right. Now, if we're going to compete with this, we're going to need a broad set of rights from the music companies. We need to go talk to the Big Five. The Big Five are the five biggest music companies in the world. Here they are. Now, before we did this, I was reminded of a quote from Hunter S. Thompson about the music industry. The music business is a cruel and shallow money trench, a long plastic hallway where thieves and pimps run free and good men die like dogs. There's also a negative side. So we didn't know what to think. Well, we went and talked to Warner first, and then to Universal, and then each one after the other, and I have to tell you, we met some great people there. And they were willing to do something with us to go change the world. And we were able to negotiate landmark deals with all the big five music companies for our music store. And let me tell you what we got. Today, we've got 200,000 tracks. We're loading in tracks every single day. This is going to keep on growing and growing and growing. And all of this music with all of these rights, you can buy for 99 cents per song with no subscription fee. Now, how much is 99 cents? Is that a lot, a little? We think it's not so much. How many of you had a Starbucks latte this morning? $3. That's three songs. How many lattes got sold across the U.S. this morning? A lot. 99 cents is pretty affordable. So, let's take a look at where we are. Vast selection. We've got 200,000 songs today and growing. We have unlimited CD burning. Instead of unlimited MP3 players, we have unlimited iPods, the most popular MP3 player in the world. Unlimited computers, we have up to 3 Macs, which we think for most people will represent unlimited. And for free, we didn't quite get the free, so we can't give ourselves green, but we got 99 cents a song, which is pretty doggone close. But now, let's take a look at the downside again. What do these things really mean? What does it mean to have unreliable downloads and unreliable encoding? Let me go through a scenario, a typical scenario. You go to Kazaa and you look for a song. You never find one song. You find 50 or 60 songs, right? And you've got to pick which one of those is going to give you a reliable download. You often pick wrong. And so the download is slow as molasses, and it craps out halfway through, right? I'm sure none of us have experienced this, but trust me, this is what happens. And you try again, you get the same result again. After trying a few times, you finally download the song, you play it. If the last 4 seconds is cut off the end, or it's got a glitch in the middle, or it was encoded by somebody that didn't quite know what they were doing, and it sounds bad. So you try it again, and you try it again. After about 15 minutes, you finally succeed in getting a clean version of the song you want. What that means is you'll spend an hour at that rate to get 4 songs that cost under $4 from Apple, and you calculate that you are working for under minimum wage. We think some people are willing to work for under minimum wage, but most aren't. And in addition, you are stealing. You are stealing. So, we look at this as tremendous opportunity to compete with these guys. So how are we going to do that? Unreliable downloads? We nailed it. Remember, we've been operating the largest movie trailer download site for years, and video takes 100 times more bits than audio. We've nailed this. We know how to pump oceans of bits reliably from server farms. We run them today. We've applied it to music. We've nailed it. In terms of encoding quality, every song is pristinely encoded. In 128 kilobit per second AAC, it rivals CD quality. And actually, because we've gone all the way back to some of the master tapes in the vault to encode these things, some of them sound better than CDs. We are offering free 30-second previews encoded at 128 kilobits AAC, the same quality for every song on the store. And we are including album cover art. So let's take a look at this. Unreliable downloads, we're going to replace with fast, reliable downloads. Unreliable encoding, we're going to replace with pristine encoding. We're going to offer previews, free 30-second previews of every song in the store. We're going to offer cover art, and it's not stealing anymore. It's good karma. So,
pretty good, huh? Sure enough, April 28th, 2003, Apple launches the iTunes Music Store. This is what it looked like. Eminem got the number one promotional spot, or Flow Case, as it was known. And Rolling Stone called it an instant revolution. Sorry, let's just get here. There we go. Apple Vice President Eddie Q predicted that the iTunes Music Store would sell 1 million downloads in 6 months. It took just 6 days. Apple quickly launched a Windows version of iTunes with the Music Store included. And with iTunes, an iPod, and the Music Store all together, Apple now owned the whole thing. And it was time for a new advertising campaign. Another advertising came from Giant Day. This one's interesting. I don't know how many of you remember it. We're maybe getting a little close to some history of the people in the room. But this was very different for Apple, right? Previously and since. A lot of Apple advertising has been this beautiful high-res photograph of a piece of hardware with maybe some nice little catchy little clever tag about why you might want it or why it's so cool or why it's so sophisticated. It was really speaking to the head. These ads are speaking to, I don't know if it's the heart, but it's the gut, right? It's about feeling. Previous ads focused on craftsmanship, showing off the product. This just showed the white iPod with the white earbuds, and it spoke to a young, new audience for Apple, right? All over the world, you'd see the Apple billboards, but these ads work best of all on television. Great ads. I still get excited seeing those ads. And this is what happened to music sales. As I mentioned at the beginning, by 2014, they've sold 35 billion songs. That's 4 songs for every person on the planet. Apple had completely reinvented the music business, becoming, I think without argument, the music business's most powerful player. And now we're going to dig a little deeper into sort of 12 decisions or 12 leadership lessons that enable this phenomenal growth. But we do have a little bit of time. If anyone's got any questions right now, I'm happy to answer. Yes. It's a great question, and I believe that's going to be the first of the ones coming up. Yeah, it's a great question, right? Why did they allow someone from the outside to come in, right? And we'll go into this in more detail, but I'll answer. I'll give you one thing straight away. They were scared, right? They were scared of outsiders, and so Steve Jobs told them. He said, "Listen, I own Macintosh. Macintosh is only 5%." Of the entire home computer business, work with me, and if it goes spectacularly wrong, it's only affecting 5% of the customer base, right? That was the argument. That's how he got them over the line. Now, we'll see that very quickly he was able to convince them that he should be allowed to open it for Windows as well and talk to everybody. But that's how he answered that question. Any more questions? Yes.
I'm assuming they have to build a close relationship with the artist themselves, where like would an artist back the project like iTunes?
Technically speaking, and from a sort of process and legal point of view, he didn't have to work with the artists at all, right? So the way it works is the artists have agreements and contracts with the record labels, who they give the license to sell and represent their music. And then the record labels then do deals with whoever they might want to work with to sell that music. And by the way, it's worth pointing that out, because an argument that still comes up to this day is, why isn't Spotify paying artists more, or why isn't Apple Music paying artists more? Well, just to be clear, it's not Spotify's or Apple Music's responsibility. Spotify or Apple Music or whoever else, they pay the record labels. Right. And then how much of that the record labels choose to pass on to their artists and how much they keep to themselves is their business. Right. But it's a great question, because Steve Jobs realized, of course, that even though technically and legally you might not need to have a relationship with artists, it's really important to get them on side. And so he reached out to 20 of the biggest artists in the world, including Elton John, Paul McCartney, Mick Jagger, Bono, who we'll hear from later, to at least get soft approval for the product, if not actual legal sign-off.
So what is your thoughts on like the iPods now? Because nobody uses them. Like, was there a reason why they kind of stop being as popular?
Yeah.
iTunes is really popular still, but
yeah.
iPods are not.
Where's mine? It's it's called iPhone. Right? iPod was the platform for iPhone, right? In many ways, iPhone, obviously it's changed so much since, but at launch, it basically was an iPod with a phone and a screen, right? Kind of, that's one way of seeing it.
But was that on the original plan, or it just happened like that?
Oh, now you're asking questions above my pay grade. We know that very early on, even before iPod, Steve Jobs wanted to launch what we now know as iPad, and that he wanted a tablet computer with a touch screen, right? And there are very early prototypes that never saw the light of day. So we know that we know that iPad was a direction he was heading in, but I think iPod and the success of iPod that led him to think, haha, maybe we can do something here a little bit more. That's my guess. Steve never confided in me. He never told me that secret.
Yes, I have a question. I understand that he launched iPod, right? But at the back of his head, he wanted a bigger plan. But I understand if I could remember correctly. So you have iPod, and then you have iPod Nano. So you have those small. Yes, so. What was the reason behind that? Because it was bulky, or?
I think it was, and this does to an extent go against one of Apple's core policies, which is to actually only work with a very, very small number of products. One of the big Apple sayings was, certainly in the early years of Steve Jobs' second time in charge, you can fit all of the Apple products on one table. Right. And he very famously said, we're only going to make two computers and two portable devices. And again, we could do another whole session on simplicity, the power that comes just focusing on one or two key things instead of doing many. But iPod was so successful as a breakout product. I think it was Phil Schiller, who runs marketing, product marketing. He very much drove the idea that we can reach a lot more different segments and serve a lot more customers by doing different versions. And frankly, as the technology evolved, it allowed it. All right, let's carry on. So, 12 leadership lessons. Now, what I've done is each of these is what Apple refers to as an attribute from what they call the leadership palette. The leadership palette is a collection of 24 attributes that Apple uses in internal training to help focus their managers and teams on good qualities that can lead to great things in the Apple universe. I've taken 12 of them, and we're gonna see. I hope they fit to each of these 12 decisions. Let's see. Just as a way of sort of keeping track. We're going to start with this one, sense the moment. Convincing the record labels. Here we go. So throughout 2001 and into 2002, CD sales continued to plummet. As we've seen, the labels had failed spectacularly to make their own legal digital alternative. Steve Jobs sensed the moment, and that's when he saw the opportunity for Apple. And it began with him recognizing that the labels were never, ever going to be able to do this on their own. And when he engaged, he proved they were quite hard to work with. I've never spent so much of my time trying to convince people to do the right thing for themselves. In his biography of Steve Jobs, Walter Isaacson describes this process as herding cats. And Steve, there's a great quote from Steve. He talks about what he learned when he went to Pixar. You remember he when he left Apple, he went to Pixar and he started working with filmmakers. And he said what he learned there was that technology companies just don't understand content businesses. They don't. They think they're undisciplined. They think they just sit around all day. They think that they don't really make things properly. And the other way around, content people don't understand technology, right? Content people could never, ever build a proper piece of technology, as we've seen. But again, the other way, a technology people could never do what content people do. So for example, like at a record label, a technology person couldn't listen to 100 bands and pick the five that are going to be successful. So Steve knew that the labels were never going to do it. So he went and he began negotiating, and he said, I think I might have a solution for you. And the label said, well, great. Yep, you need to give us a share of the profits of iPod. And Steve said, no, we're not going to do that. And he said, well, fine. Well, you're going to have to let us have direct access to the customers that use this music store. And Steve said, no, we're not going to do that. But in the end, they got there. And the way that he did it was he created a working demo that he could take around the labels and show them exactly how it's going to work. And eventually they signed up. Now this slide looks a little wrong. This is what happens when you try and turn Mac slides into PC slides, right? But let's see. All right, no, we can make this work. So eventually he did get the labels to agree, right? And this is exactly hopefully answering your question. And what we're gonna do is this is called Gleischer's formula for change, right? And it's a way of looking at organizations and businesses and seeing when can change happen and when can't, right? And what this formula says is that change can happen if dissatisfaction with the way things are now, coupled with a vision of how things could be, combined with a concrete plan of how you can get there, right? First steps. Okay, it's one thing to have a vision, but is it practical? Can we get there? If those three things combined are bigger than the resistance to change, then change can happen, right? And in 2003 in the music business, dissatisfaction, huge dissatisfaction. You saw the graph. You saw what was happening to their revenues, right? They needed it. Vision of what's possible. Steve had built it. He showed you, right? First steps, he showed that too. All you got to do is sign up, and you can start selling your music as soon as we launch it. And it was enough. Now, resistance. Was there any resistance? Yes, there was some, right? There was resistance to an outsider coming in. But again, he told them, listen, I'm just 5% of the market. Treat this as an experiment. If it goes wrong, you've still got the other 95%. Sense the moment. Next, obsess over the customer experience. And this is about downloads versus subscriptions. In response to Napster, the vast majority of the legal alternatives that sprang up, I showed you two of them, there were others, none of them succeeded. But the majority of them were subscription services, like Spotify or Apple Music is today, right? The labels wanted subscription services because they hoped that this new digital business was going to be a new revenue stream and wasn't going to cannibalize their existing CD business, right? They were still thinking about the CD business. And the thinking was that, hey, Napster offered people access to the entire world's music library. They can take as much of it as they want. Let's offer them that. We know that that's what works. We'll just put some limitations on it and charge them a monthly fee, right? And you'd think that the success of Spotify today and Apple Music, you'd think that that was the right decision, right? But Steve Jobs saw it differently. He publicly rubbished the idea of subscription services. He says people don't want to rent their music. They don't want to spend $1,000. He gave the example, $1,000 over 10 years just to play your favorite song on your birthday. He said people aren't going to do it. He was very vocal. And in one interview in 2003 with Rolling Stone, he went even further. You could make available the second coming in a subscription model and it might not be successful. And so when Apple pushed forward with a download to own store, it prompted some surprise. Strange, said Bill Gates, who'd been working on his own legal music service with Microsoft. We know this from internal memos that have subsequently come to light. And Bill went on to say to his executives, I'm not saying that this strangeness means we messed up. At least if we did, so did Real and Press Play and MusicNet and basically everyone else. He went on to concede that Apple had created a very, very powerful consumer product with iTunes. Microsoft had been caught flat-footed and that they'd need to work hard to catch up. So why? Why was downloads right at this time? Why was subscriptions wrong? The truth is that the mass market wasn't ready for a subscription service, right? Yes, the diehards, the early adopters, the music geeks, they'd flocked to Napster. Maybe you could sell a music subscription service to them, but their moms and dads, right? All the other people that weren't using a computer, right? They were used to the idea of buying music, right? And the mass market was exactly who Steve Jobs was aiming for. People are used to buying their music. And we think people want to buy their music on the internet by buying downloads. He recognized that changing behavior is very, very difficult, right? If you're dealing with the mass market, changing behavior is hugely difficult. The easier you make it, the more familiar you make it, the more people will come with you. In 2003, as the mass market began to move from physical to digital consumption, the download to own model offered familiarity and simplicity. Subscriptions could come later. Next, foster trust. That's not my note. There you go. Nope, I'll take. All right, I'll take that one. Yes, thank you. One-click purchase. A big reason why iTunes was such a success was it was so easy to use, right? And this comes up time and time again with Apple products. They are easy to use. Famously, they don't come with instruction manuals, right? You pick them up, you can just start using them. With iTunes, you could buy songs and albums with just one click. Now, that might not seem like a big deal today, but back in 2003, this was a huge deal. And why was one-click purchase so rare back in those days? Because it required customers trusting an online store with their personal details, with their credit card information, giving that store permission to charge that credit card for purchases whenever it wanted, right? It required a lot of trust. And in 2003, back at the beginning of e-commerce, trust was in short supply. There weren't many companies that could do this. Apple was only one of them. Apple's market share of the home computer market at that time might have only been 5%, but that 5% trusted Apple implicitly, right? They were devoted. They had no problem creating Apple IDs, trusting Apple with the credit card information. And when they did it, the rest followed. Microsoft couldn't have done this. Dell Computer couldn't have done this. The record labels certainly couldn't have done it. And it brought two huge benefits. Ease of use. iTunes was super easy to use. And it also meant that by 2011, Apple had amassed almost a quarter of a billion accounts of people who trusted Apple with their credit card information and could bill them for purchases. And at the dawn of digital commerce, that put Apple in some very, very good company. The lesson here is build trust, right? Build trust with your customers, and then they'll come on the journey with you. Next. Focus and simplify. Again, this is such a common theme with Apple. There's a great story, and this is in the Walter Isaacson biography. At Apple, Steve Jobs used to have what's called Top 100. And this is a sort of informal club of the 100 people that Steve would take with him if he had to start Apple all over again, right? So these are the high flyers. These are the most important people at Apple. each year he would take these top 100 on an offsite, and they would start their session in a big room like this one, and Steve would be up front with a whiteboard, and he'd ask, right, what are the 10 things that we should be doing next? And these 100 high flyers would fight to get just 10 things, right? 100, they've all got their own priorities. You've got to get 100 into 10, right? They fight, and eventually they have their list of 10. And then Steve would go up to the whiteboard and erase numbers 4 to 10. And they'd say, we can do only 3, right? Focus and simplify again and again and again. This comes up in the Apple story. So how does this relate to iTunes? 99 cents, right? Simple, right? Super simple. And here's Steve on the subject, right? Simple can be harder than complex. You have to work hard to get your thinking clean to make it simple. But it's worth it in the end, because once you get there, you can move mountains. Again, countless examples. The original one-button mouse on Macintosh. iPhone's touchscreen. The AirPods charging case, right? Simplicity. And it's not just the products, it's also the messaging. 1,000 songs in your pocket, right? Perfectly clear messaging. Very simple, hugely effective. So, what was the messaging for iTunes? Let's take a look. This is one of the very first video commercials for iTunes.
I big butts and I cannot lie. You other brothers can't deny. When a girl walks in with the itty bitty waist and a round thing in your face, you get sprung. Wanna throw up stuff cause notes that butt was stuck. Even the jeans she's wearing, I'm hooked and I can't stop staring. No, baby, I wanna get with ya and take your picture. My homeboys tried to warn me, but that butt you got me, to me, don't want it. Ruffle smooth skin, you say you wanna get my bends? Well, use me, abuse me, cause you ain't that average groupie. People try to put us down, talking about my generation, just because we get around, talking about my generation. Things they do look awful cold, talking about my generation. I hope I die before I get old, talking about my generation. My generation is my generation, baby, yeah.
Yeah, funny ads, right? Working very hard to show that iTunes is for everyone, right? It's not for cool kids. It's not for music experts. It's not for technology geeks. It's for everyone, right? And the value offer is simple. Your favorite songs, 99 cents each, right? Your favorite songs, 99 cents each. 99 cents. This is what the record label wanted. they didn't want just one price point. They wanted a whole bunch. They argued, fairly perhaps, that the global hit, I'm Too Sexy, is probably worth more than all the other songs on the Right Said Fred album. I don't know if that means anything to anybody. You could pick any one. Stairway to Heaven, right? It's probably worth more than the other songs on Led Zeppelin 4, right? They said it didn't seem right that you should charge the same for Beethoven's 7-minute Moonlight Sonata as you do for the 1-minute Ode to Joy, right? Reasonable. And they also knew that they could charge a lot more than 99 cents for a hot new single on release day from a superstar artist. Right. But Steve Jobs held firm. He demanded that every song be available for 99 cents. Napster's impact had been huge, but for the majority of people, for the mass market, getting your music online was something new. And he knew that to convert the mainstream audience to come on board, he had to make it super easy. Your favorite songs, 99 cents, easy to communicate, easy to understand, simple. Demand difference. That is right. My mistake. Songs, not albums. Your favorite songs, 99 cents each, not albums. Apple demanded that labels make every song available for individual sale, right? There was huge pushback. After years of selling $20 CDs to people who maybe only wanted the one or two songs that they really wanted from that album, the labels were reluctant to allow customers to cherry pick the songs they wanted. They would try all sorts of things. They'd deliver albums to us, and the one hit song on the album, they'd make it not available for purchase. You have to buy the whole album to get this particular song. No, we'd push it back. We'd say, no, you've got to make it available. This was a huge, huge battle. And Steve said, listen, piracy has already deconstructed the album, right? The days of thinking that an album of music in the old way that you used to think about it exists, it's gone, right? Napster killed that. And now you've got to come with us, and we've got to try and build a new business together of people who understand that they want one song and they're going to get it. This was tricky, right? Because this is where, and thanks for your question earlier on, this is where artists come into it, right? Because it's the labels that controlled the albums, but guess what? The artists had an opinion too. And there are lots of artists who said, well, hang on a minute. You can look at the labels and you can say that they're kind of cheating customers by putting one song that they want and then filling up nine other songs and making people buy the whole CD. But that's not me. That's not how I approach making my music. I make an album and I want people to listen to it all the way through in the order that I've properly curated it. And I don't want you selling individual songs. AC/DC, Kid Rock, Led Zeppelin, Garth Brooks, Def Leppard, Frank Zappa. This argument over whether or not songs should be available individually was a part of arguments with all these artists, which led to them not being available on iTunes, right? But that's the line we said. If you're not going to come with us, if you're not going to make your songs available, you're not going to be on iTunes. And that hurt Apple, right? In the press, being labeled as artist unfriendly, right? Railroading artists into chopping up the album. But no, again, putting the customer first, right? Steve held firm. And eventually, all these artists came around, right? And you can now get all of these on iTunes and Apple Music. And let me add, the album is alive and well, right? There was a lot of talk at the time about this is the death of the album. No, the album's just fine for those artists that want to make them. Next, wrestle with Apple's premises. It's one thing holding to your ideals and holding to your principles. And we can see that that's in the last example, putting the customer first was something that I believe, and I think history has proven, was a big part of iTunes' success. But there's times when you've got to examine and look in the mirror and sometimes break with your own premises. Let's take another look at iPod. It's a classic experience of Apple delivering superb usability by owning the entire end-to-end experience. And here's what Steve Jobs had to say about it. He said, in order to make the iPod really easy to use, and this took a lot of arguing on my part, we needed to limit what the device itself would do. Instead, we put that functionality in iTunes on the computer. For example, we made it so you couldn't make playlists using the device. That was controversial, right? So again, you're selling a portable music player, right? And you can't make playlists? No, You do that on the computer and then you transfer it onto the iPod. That's how it works, right? But what made our, and this is Steve Jobs again, but what made our competitors' devices so brain dead was that they were complicated. They had to do things like make playlists because they weren't integrated with the jukebox software on your computer. So by owning the iTunes software and the iPod, that allowed us to make the computer and the device work together. And it allowed us to put the complexity in the right place, right? Famously, iPod just comes with this click wheel, right? Because Apple owns this, the computer and the software, it can put complexity in the right place. It can make this beautiful product that everyone loves, and you can still make playlists. And that worked fine when it was the Mac, right? But starting in 2002, as we've learned, they also started selling iPods for Windows, right? And how are Windows customers going to make their playlists, and how's that going to create a beautiful joined up user experience? And of course the answer was that the software they were using with their iPod was really shonky, it didn't work, and that drove Steve Jobs mad because it meant people using iPods, an Apple product, had a bad experience because part of the sequence involved something that Apple wasn't controlling. So how do you fix this problem? There's only one way you can do it, something that a few years ago would have seemed utterly unthinkable, and now Apple launches iTunes for Windows. It doesn't seem like a big deal, maybe, but for Apple, this was a big, big deal. So big a deal, Steve described it as hell freezing over when it was announced. It was the very first time Apple had made its software available outside of the Macintosh ecosystem. He later quipped that making an iTunes version for Windows was like giving a glass of ice water to someone in hell, which I don't think amused Bill Gates too much. But it meant that they could own this entire user experience, and it would be the experience that Apple wanted. But that wasn't easy. All right. See around corners. There's an old Wayne Gretzky quote that I love. Wayne Gretzky is a famous ice hockey player, by the way, which I'm sure all the North Americans here know all about Wayne Gretzky. Yeah. He said, "I skate to where the puck is going to be, not to where it's been." So, desperate to avoid fueling more piracy, the labels demanded that all the songs sold on iTunes come with DRM, digital rights management. It's a control that limits what purchasers can do with those song files. The idea was that only the person buying the song could play it, right? Noble intention. Apple came up with its own DRM system that it called Fair Play. And it argued quite hard with the labels to keep the DRM restrictions to a minimum, right? Steve Jobs didn't really believe in DRM, but again, he hated the fact that when customers ran up against DRM restrictions, they thought that somehow it was their iPod that was broken, or somehow these were Apple's rules that were stopping their enjoyment. So he came up with his own system called Fair Play. And working with the labels, he'd worked out that songs could play on a maximum of 5 authorized computers, which, as we know from his video, he believed, and I think it's common sense, for most people, 5 authorized computers, that's enough. No one's got more than 5. And maximum 7 CD burns of the same playlist. I think that's reasonable as well. Again, yeah, these are the messages that come up when you run up against them. Steve hated these. And sure enough, customers hated it too, right? Soon there were customer-led campaigns to get rid of DRM altogether. But in truth, much as Steve and Apple hated this DRM, hated these restrictions placed upon the customer's enjoyment of the Apple products, it did also offer Apple a bit of an advantage. Steve had convinced the labels that if Apple had to use DRM, then it should be allowed to use its own. And it wouldn't share its DRM system with any other music player manufacturer or digital music store. This meant that songs bought on iTunes wouldn't play on any of iPod's rivals, just iPod. And iPod would refuse to play any song bought on a rival digital music store. You can see that when iPod was enjoying over 70% of market share, that offered Apple some pretty serious advantages, right? It meant that customers within the iPod Apple ecosystem could keep on using iPod and iTunes, but people outside couldn't join in. Eventually, a lot of competition authorities started saying that maybe this was something they needed to look at and something we needed to fix, and that maybe Apple should share its DRM technology with other manufacturers and open it all up. And that's when Steve Jobs pivoted. He pivoted and he wrote an open letter to the music business saying that we should get rid of DRM altogether. A DRM-free world is clearly the best alternative for customers, and Apple would embrace it in a heartbeat, he said. He made numerous arguments as to why DRM was flawed, but his best argument was that the record labels continued to sell billions of CDs every year. And those CDs came with no DRM restrictions at all, right? Rip, mix, burn. Put that CD in your computer, turn it into digital files, do what you want with them, right? So why make the online platforms who are trying to build a new business, trying to get at the record labels out of this problem, why put restrictions on them when they're not putting them on the CDs? And within 2 months, iTunes was selling DRM-free music. Fight for excellence. Steve Jobs wanted to increase the audio quality of the music that was sold on iTunes. At launch, iTunes delivered files to customers that were 128K AAC files. The small file size allowed quick downloads. You could fit quite a lot of them on an iPod. And for most people, the quality was absolutely good enough. And in actual fact, most people, if you play them an 128K AAC file and you play them a CD, they can't tell the difference, right? But unarguably, it was lower quality, right? It was lower quality. And as iTunes grew, a vocal minority of people complained that quality had been sacrificed for convenience. Many artists joined the... Neil Young was one of the most outspoken. He called out Steve Jobs. And he said, you know, you run the responsibility to make sure that customer music has possible quality. And Steve Jobs agreed. He wanted to do that too. The labels to do it. The labels appreciated the download business, right? But they wanted the download business to live alongside the CD business, right? The CD business was still more profitable for them. Yes, it was been in decline, and it had been in decline, but it was still huge. And they were making more money from that than they were from iTunes. And one of the reasons people were buying CDs is because of the higher audio quality. So how is Steve going to tempt them? Well, 4 years after launch, now that the world understood what iTunes was and how it works, now you didn't have to be so simple in your customer offer. He gave the labels what they wanted, right? And he gave the labels two additional price points. He said, okay, if you're willing to let me sell your music at a much higher quality, I'll let you charge a higher price for it. And at the same time, with a lower price for all the stuff that maybe hasn't been selling so much, and maybe we can drive some sales at a lower price point. So iTunes Plus was launched. EMI was the first label to go, and soon they delivered a lot of their catalog, and they've got some of the best at 256K, much higher quality, and they were able to charge 129 for it. Soon all the other labels followed, and iTunes was able to have a dedicated area for high-res music or high audio quality. At the same time, a 59p songs or 69 cent songs room proved to be a real good business driver for deep catalog and songs that perhaps otherwise weren't getting the same level of promotion. Sales boomed, everyone made a lot more money, the customers were happy, happy days. All right, we're getting down to the last few. Stay curious, right? Stay curious. And this is one that affected me personally, because I was the head of music for iTunes in UK at the time. And this was very much a UK issue. Sorry, just getting my notes. So in our quest to offer customers every song at 99 cents, or at least every song, the main battle was with the labels, right? Getting them to deliver everything to us, unlock it, blah, 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 convince the artists, you want to be with us. But we also had another problem. And it was all to do with the official charts, or the top 40. And here I've got to give you a little bit of background. Record labels and artists love being number one, right? And if they can't be number one, they want to be in the top 10. Right? And better than being number one is straight in at number one, right? The chart is hugely, hugely important in the music ecosystem. Having a number one single can make an artist's career, right? An artist coming back after a break with a second or third album, the single goes in at 25 or 30, that can kill a career, right? The chart is hugely, hugely important. So the labels were desperate that all their songs achieve the highest possible chart position. Now, what they'd done is they'd done their research. They worked out that an average music listener needs to listen to a song for 5 or 6 weeks before liking it enough to buy it, right? 5 or 6 weeks. So in the UK, what they'd do is they would give it to the radio stations 5 or 6 weeks before the release date and invite the record stations to play it, right? The record stations would play it. And the idea was that come release date, demand would be at a peak. And that as soon as it goes on sale, lots of people will buy it and boom, in at number one. This is how it worked. It was called the champagne cork effect. This is my diagram, by the way. I get all the credit. 5 or 6 weeks before release, the radio stations play the new song. On release day, boom, loads of people buy it. Straight in the charts, right? Now, in the olden days, the vinyl and tapes and CDs, this worked well for everybody, right? It worked for record labels because they could work this system and they could get their number ones. It worked great for Radio One and the radio to listen to the new music that wasn't out yet. It worked great for the official charts company because they got a volatile, exciting chart. The age of additional benefit for the record labels because based on early listener feedback, they could get an idea of how many of these things they should manufacture in anticipation of release date, right? They got a bit of market research. But in the new digital marketplace, there was a problem. Now, can anyone see what the problem might be? I'm sorry?
You can record it while it was playing.
Yeah, absolutely. in this new digital marketplace, the moment it was played on a radio station, someone somewhere will record it, and then it'll be up on the piracy sites, and it'll be up on YouTube, and it'll be up in countless other places, right? Which meant the customers then had to decide, right? Do they wait 5 weeks to buy it, or do they go to YouTube and listen to it now for free? Right. It quickly became clear that we and the record labels were losing millions, hundreds of millions of sales, right? But it was obvious to us, it was obvious to me and my team on iTunes UK at the time, the solution was easy, right? You just go to the labels and you say, well, hang on, instead of giving it to the radio 5 weeks before, make it available at the same time. No one's going to lose any sales. There'll still be a number one every week. It's a pretty simple change to your release strategy, right? And we thought, yeah, I'm amazed they haven't spotted this, right? So we suggested it, and the labels did nothing. The labels continued with the exact same policy. They wouldn't change. And it took us a little while to work out why, right? Let's take a look at the formula for change again. Dissatisfaction with the way things are. Well, you're losing hundreds of millions, at least tens of millions of song sales, right? It's a problem. Vision of what's possible. Instead of letting radio play your songs 5 or 6 weeks ahead, give it to them the same day you make it for sale, and we're not gonna have the same problem. First steps, just do it, right? It's not difficult. And the resistance, well, what resistance can there be, right? Come on, this is a no-brainer. But no, we'd got it wrong. Turns out that we'd completely overestimated the dissatisfaction. We'd completely underestimated the difficulty of the first steps. And we completely underestimated the amount of resistance, right? Dissatisfaction with the way things are now. The truth is that the major record labels, the biggest ones, they loved the fact that they had the best relationships with radio stations, they had the biggest marketing budgets, they could make this system work for them, right? All the little radio stations, all the independent artists, they weren't in this game. The majors, it was theirs, and they did not want to let go of that control, right? As one major record label put it to me very eloquently at the time, he said, your mistake is you think I'm in the business of selling music. No, I'm in the business of getting number ones, right? Number ones, we'd vastly underestimated number ones, right? We knew again, yeah, it's okay. Britney Spears, she wants to come back with a number one, right? Coldplay, it's important to them that they come back in the top 10. No. The whole industry is looking at week one chart position to decide whether or not it's going to back that artist and whether this project's a winner or whether not, right? The people booking artists to play in festivals in the summer, right? Do you want to book the artist that's in at number one, or do you want to book the artist that is in at number seven? We'll go with the number ones, thanks, right? How many CDs are HMV going to order of the new album? Well, if they're in at number one, we'll order 200,000, but oh, they're only in 11. Yeah, all right. Okay, maybe we'll only go with 50,000, right? All the way down the chain, the entire music business is based on trying to back winners, and the number one signal was week one chart position. We'd underestimated that. Next thing we got wrong, first steps, right? All you got to do is change, right? All you got to do is change and not give your music to radio. Don't go for this buildup. Don't go for this champagne cork effect. Just release it at the same time. There'll still be winners and losers, right? There'll still be a number one. There'll still be a number seven, right? Work out a different way to win that game. But it only works, and you can only make this change if everybody changes at the exact same time. It's classic game theory. It's called prisoner's dilemma, right? If all the labels had changed on the exact same day, it would be fine, right? There'd still be winners and losers. No one would have an advantage over the others. But if some of the labels made the change and a couple of them held back and didn't, the ones that held back and didn't would have a huge advantage over the ones that did. And guess what? Next week, they'd be number one, right? And so it required the labels to all act in concert at the same time. And I think, as we've already seen, they were incapable of that level of organization, right? So it turned out it was impossible. And then we'd also underestimated resistance, right? Turns out that radio, they quite liked the fact that people had to listen to radio to hear the new hit singles, right? And radio were the kingmakers. Radio were super, super important in deciding who works and who doesn't, right? You can make the best song in the world, but if it's not played on Radio 1 or Los 40, right, most people are never going to hear it, right? In 2011, the Guardian newspaper in the UK did their annual Power 100, the 100 most important, influential people in the music business. As head of music for iTunes, I was number 5. The head of playlist at Radio 1 was number 4. Adele was number 1, by the way. Eventually they changed, right? Because it just got too much. It was just obvious that too many sales were being lost. Universal Music went first, they're the biggest label. But this wasn't until 8 years after the launch of iTunes. It took that long. Stay curious, right? All right. I've saved the three sexiest ones for the end, right? Beyonce. In 2013, Beyonce is probably the world's biggest pop star. Lady Gaga has had a couple of big hits, grabbing a lot of the headlines. And Beyonce needs to do something to stay on top, right? And she's also got her eye on history. Her first 4 albums have all gone to number 1 in the Billboard charts in the States. No female artist has ever had 5 in a row. She wants 5 in a row. And then this happened.
Beyonce. The superstar dropping a brand new album overnight, complete with music videos for every track and then some, taking her fans and the music world quite by surprise. The midnight surprise sent fans into a frenzy. Beyonce's album, titled simply Beyonce, features tracks with husband, rapper Jay-Z. Even the power couple's daughter Blue Ivy makes her video debut in the new song, Blue. It was an unprecedented move that surprised fans and the music industry, announcing and releasing her album on the same day. 14 songs, complete with 17 music videos. Add in an enticing Instagram video and another on Facebook, where Beyonce explains why she kept the release under wraps.
I felt like I don't want anybody to give the message when my record is coming out. I just want this to come out when it's ready, and from me to my fans.
And the fans were happy. One tweeting, only Beyonce can drop a visual bomb with 17 videos, no promotion, and it was all kept a secret. There's a reason why she is called the queen.
So yeah, on December the 13th, 2013, Beyonce's 5th album drops completely by surprise, exclusively on iTunes, right? Huge, huge, huge result for us, right? For iTunes. 14 songs, 14 music videos, $15.99. And it's a huge success. Huge success. Shatters iTunes store records. Almost 1 million sold in just 3 days. The album did debut at number 1. She got her world record, 5 in a row. So how did it happen? What did we offer Beyonce to make this happen? Well, there were a few things involved in the deal, but I think the interesting thing one to talk about here is this is the album page. Now, does anyone notice anything interesting about this album page? You're going to get good points if anyone spots this. Nope, not mastered for iTunes. Nope, that's good point. That's been out for a while. That shows it's in high quality. Album only. We will only sell your album if you make all the songs available for individual purchase. Well, looks like we broke one of our own rules, right? Now, in our defense, let's go back to this. In our defense, the main reason we'd said that all songs needed to be available for individual purchase was that we knew customers would come to the store wanting a particular song, and if they then found that they had to buy the whole album, they'd get ripped off, right? In this case, no one even knew this album was coming. No one had heard any of the songs. No one was going to look down that list of songs and say, oh, I only want to buy that one, right? That was one reason. Second reason, it's Beyonce. from that amazing start, sales remained huge throughout the year. She went on to win 3 Grammys. Huge success for everybody. Approach problems flexibly. Next, drive what matters. Who can follow Beyonce? Maybe these guys. In 2010, sales are booming, but some artists are still not along for the ride, right? By this time, we've got the Rolling Stones, we've got Metallica, we're still missing AC/DC, a couple of others, but the one that we're really missing, the Beatles, right? The most important, and I would say the best band in the history of popular music. Why no Beatles? The biggest reason was a decades-long argument over the name of Apple. In 1968, the Beatles had started their own company to release their music. It was called Apple Corps. And then in 1976, when Steve Jobs chose the name Apple, now he said it was because he wanted it to be in front of Atari in the phone book. But either way, it caused a problem with the Beatles and with Apple Corps. As part of a 1981 settlement, Steve Jobs agreed that in order to continue using the name, he would stay out of the music business. But when loudspeakers and a headphone jack were added to Apple's computers, that argument restarted. And you can see that with the launch of iPod, iTunes Music Store, right? Now, eventually in 2007, 3 years after the launch of iTunes Music Store, now that argument is settled. And eventually that legal dispute's out the way. A long and winding road, indeed. And then 3 years later in 2010, the music business was wild with rumors that eventually the Beatles would be coming to iTunes. The hype started building. It made it into the newspapers. There was a lot of speculation that the day that the Beatles music goes on sale at iTunes, the whole top 40 will be Beatles songs, right? Now we knew that that wouldn't happen, right? We knew that by 2010, anybody who wanted the Beatles on their iPod had found a way to get it there, right? The year before, the labels had done a huge project with remastered versions of all the Beatles albums. They'd sold hundreds of millions of CDs. We knew that hugely important though the Beatles were, they weren't going to sell in that bigger number, right? They just weren't. The Beatles really was just for the generation above our core audience, right? They were for baby boomers, Gen Xers. The majority of our customers cared about other things, right? The majority of our customers cared more about X Factor, right? Which is, I'm ashamed to say, but it's true. On November the 16th, 2010, the entire Beatles catalogue is available for sale. And this is what it looked like. We received strict instructions from Cupertino on how to promote the Beatles. And it was basically promote only the Beatles. they took over the whole thing, right? It was like nothing we'd ever done before, right? And why were we doing this? Well, as part of the negotiations, Steve Jobs had promised that we would give blanket promotion all over the store for the entire Christmas period, right? And worse, in my point of view, at the time, he'd committed our entire marketing budget to promoting Beatles music, right? Music that I knew wasn't going to sell, right? Hugely important, but I knew it wasn't going to sell, right? This was a disaster, right? Sure enough, this is the top 40, the week after everything goes on sale. Number one, JLS, Take That, Ellie Goulding. You're all the way down to 40, right? Hey Jude, in at number 40, right? Stupid Steve Jobs, eh? Yeah. Not so fast, right? iTunes was important to me and hugely important to Apple, but iPhone? iPhone is the biggest business, right? In the summer of 2010, iTunes may have sold over 10 billion songs, but iPhone was generating 100 times the profits for Apple. iPhone sales were almost doubling year on year. The market was in huge growth, and Steve was looking at the bigger picture. You remember these commercials? Do you remember these ads? This is the Think Different ad, right? 1997 campaign, placing the Apple brand next to some of the most charismatic and important people in the history of the world, right? Political leaders, adventurers, entertainers, scientists, sports stars, and of course, musicians, right? All that time ago, billboards all over the world reintroduced Apple to the world by putting the Apple brand next to some of the most important people in history. And what has Steve Jobs done? He did it all over again. In our deal with the Beatles, right, Apple secured a version 2.0 of the most successful advertising campaign in technology history, right? And the Beatles thought he was doing them a favor. And sure enough, the following year, iPhone sales sold in their millions and millions and millions to Gen Xers and baby boomers, to Beatles fans. Drive what matters, right? See the bigger picture. All right, last one. How are we doing? Yeah, we're just about on time. Own the hard calls. I spent 16 years at Apple. I'm a huge fan, as you can probably tell from this presentation, and iTunes is a classic case of everything that Apple does so well. But it didn't always go well. And we're gonna finish on one example where it didn't go well at all, but we learned some very, very valuable lessons. Does everyone know this man? This is Bono. So Bono and Steve Jobs were friends. And we've had some great questions tonight. Someone asked, did we reach out to artists? Yes, we did at the beginning. And Bono was one of the very first artists that Steve Jobs talked to. And he gave a demo to Bono and he showed it how it's going to work. And Bono very early on was engaged. Bono would visit with Steve in California. He'd go around for dinner. They'd listen to music and talk about technology. Steve had an apartment in Manhattan, which he never actually ever stayed in. Bono bought it from him. Bono had publicly stated that iPod was the most beautiful objet d'art in music culture since the electric guitar. And when the Windows version of iTunes Store opened, Bono appeared at the announcement on video to say, it's a very cool thing for musicians and music. That's why I'm here to kiss the corporate ass. I don't kiss everybody's. And in 2004, a month before the release of U2's new single, Bono and U2's manager at the time, a guy called Paul McGuinness, was in California meeting with Steve Jobs. He'd seen the iPod commercials, right, the silhouettes and the white earbuds and the beautiful music. And he said, well, listen, why don't you do a silhouette commercial for our new single? And according to the story, Steve said, well, I can't afford to pay you what you'll no doubt ask for the licensing fee. And Bono said, that's okay, just give me some Apple stock. And Steve said, no, not going to do that. And so the story goes, Bono said, well, how about you you sell a U2 branded iPod? How about we do that? And Steve said, well, we could mock one up, but I don't think you're going to like it. And anyway, they got Johnny Ive to mock one up, and it turned out they did like it. And it turned out going on sale, and this is the U2 branded iPod. Came with their signatures on the back. You could buy a special version that came preloaded with all their music. Johnny Ive later speculated that he thought most people who bought it only because it was black. And up until that point, you could only get white ones. And sure enough, Bono got his own iPod commercial. Cool, huh? Total bromance. 10 years later, Bono's back in Cupertino, this time meeting with a new CEO of Apple. Album that he's looking to work with, it's called Songs of Innocence. And he had an idea. And he managed to convince Tim Cook to do it. And at an Apple event in October 2014, you two were the surprise guests who played a song from the new album. And then this happened.
Look, this time last week, we finished our album. It's called Songs of Innocence. We're very excited about it. The question is now, Zen Master, how do we get it to as many people as possible? Because that's what our band is all about.
Wait, are we the very first people to see this in the world?
Yes. Kind of see it.
Is this a white label copy?
That's a white label copy, that is. And the question is, and I think you can help us, how do we get this to as many people as possible?
Well, you know, we do have iTunes.
I do believe you have over 500 million subscribers to iTunes, so could you get this to them?
Sure, we could do that.
Could you, like, do it in, like, 5 seconds just by pressing a sort of magic Apple send button? You could do that?
If we gave it away for free.
But first you would have to pay for it. Because we're not going in for the free music round here. You would consider?
I've been told I'm a good negotiator.
You would consider putting Songs of Innocence out to over half a billion people free in, say, 5 seconds from now?
Yes. We could. We press the button, it'll take a little longer to get all the way across the internet, but it can start in 5 seconds.
So you two, let me just get this straight. U2's new album, Songs of Innocence, is going out for free to a half a billion people in the next 5 seconds. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Wow, that's instant gratification. Did that really happen? Did that really happen?
We're not kidding. That just happened.
It happened. High fives all round. Well, sure enough, over the next day, the new U2 album appeared in everybody's music library, right? It could have put up a button saying, click here and get a free U2 album. No, it appeared in everybody's album. And while there were a couple of hundred thousand U2 fans who thought this was the best thing ever, there were several hundred million other music fans who thought this was a bit of a problem. I woke up this morning to find Bono in my kitchen, drinking my coffee, wearing my dressing gown, reading my paper. The new U2 album is overpriced. And there was quite a lot of this. Yeah, it was a total press disaster. What Apple had done was very, very uncharacteristically, it had completely misunderstood its relationship between it and its customers and the level of respect and the level of trust. It had to release a special update just so people could get rid of this album. To this day, I still meet people who tell me that this comes up on shuffle or, yeah?
That's what I was just having.
Oh. Yeah. Oh.
Impossible to get rid of.
Yeah. It's enough to make you want to tell Bono to. Yeah. Bono. This is Bono. At first, I thought this was just an internet squall. We were Santa Claus, and we'd knocked a few bricks out as we went down the chimney with our bag of songs. But quite quickly, we realized that we'd bumped into a serious discussion about the access of big tech to our lives. He blames himself. Tim Cook took it on the chin. You talked us into an experiment. We ran with it. It may not have worked, but we have to experiment because the music business in its present form is not working for everyone. And he's right. Right? They didn't make too many mistakes. This was one. It does make you wonder if it would have happened under Steve Jobs. I'm as proud of the things we haven't done as I am of the things we have done. Innovation is saying no to 1,000 things. Again, that list of 10, we can do only 3, right? And that's it. Thank you very, very much for listening. I hope some of this was interesting. And we've now got a little bit of time for Q&A.
Thank you. I have a question. So where does iTunes go now? I mean, what's the next big thing? Do you have any secrets or?
Well, I no longer work at Apple. I left at the end of last year. So I don't know any of the secrets. But as we know, iTunes gave way to Apple Music. And this idea of a subscription model of paying an amount of money and then being able to listen to whatever you want on a monthly basis, that clearly now is the mainstream. And while iTunes does still exist in the Apple Music app, or rather it's still possible to buy downloads, subscription is now the dominant way. Yeah, but it's interesting, right? A challenge faced by all the subscription services, Spotify and Apple Music and the others, is that there's a whole new generation of kids coming up who just aren't interested. They get all the music they want on TikTok, right? Yeah, and you can talk about attention spans, you can talk about whatever else, but the truth is my kids, they listen to a bit of music on these services, but they get most of it other ways. That's the challenge. Yes.
I have a question. It's not exactly about iTunes, it's more about the music industry. So we're talking about TikTok right now, and that reminded me that how do charts work now, that it doesn't only depend on what radios are playing and what music is coming up. I'm thinking about, so Taylor Swift is re-recording a lot of her music, and then suddenly, because of the TikTok trend, one of her old songs is number one.
Yeah. Yeah, well, it's an interesting, it's a very interesting question. And all of the platforms, so Apple Music, Spotify, and all the people still selling physical CDs, vinyl, they all report to the various official chart companies. In the UK, it's called the Official Chart Company. In the US, it's Billboard. Every country's got its own version of the charts. But those companies need to decide on two things. Firstly, they need to decide on who's contributing, right? And at the beginning, and TikTok, for example, do they include TikTok plays in the chart or not, right? They've got to decide. They only listen to 20 seconds worth of the song. Should that count? If so, should it count as much as someone who bought the song? Should it count as much as someone who streamed the song 20 times? So they've got to decide who contributes, and they've got to decide how the different contributing factors are weighed against each other to make a chart. And they're really interested in two things. They're interested in, one, it being fair, but they also want it to be lively, right? And one problem that we've got with this new world of streaming is that the chart now moves very slowly. And we all see that songs are at number one for like 8 weeks, maybe 10 weeks, 12 weeks. And the chart companies don't like that because they want people tuning in every week to get the latest updates. So it's an ongoing debate. What am I doing now?
Aside from being here with us, you're probably one of the money, that you're in you were in a great company. I for some things it's a great company, for other things it's like, come on folks, get back together, because there's a lot of things that I see that I'm one of the sustainability master students here, and that's one of the things I don't see in that company at all. And it's just wondering, what are your ventures now, just out of curiosity, after being there? I'm certainly, for you it's the next step.
I wish I'm working that out. Thank you. But for now, I'm genuinely enjoying telling some Apple stories and meeting people like you, genuinely.
Great.
Yeah.
Really do appreciate you coming to see us.
Not at all.
Great for the insight.
I have a question about the business part of the music. Do you think that the revenue has changed because of the change of model? It's going a little bit the same as the media, how the media, the digital world has completely changed the business model of the media. Is digitalization and technology also making it, and it goes with the question that Marta did as well, harder now for record labels to own and control careers? Singers are taking control, but users are taking control as well. So how it all, it all seems a bit confusing to make any money out of it.
Sure. Well, let me answer your question two ways. You remember the graph that we saw at the beginning about the revenues, they went up to 20 billion. Right, in 2010, then they crashed. What it's done since then is it's gone down, even through the age of iTunes, right? And now it's climbing back up again, right? And Apple, for example, Apple, and this was true of a couple of years ago, is now paying more through to the labels than ever they were at the peak of iTunes, right? So the music business is on the up, right? That's the good news. And also the revenues for the music businesses, and that they love this, are a lot more dependable, right? It's they can count, because it's monthly subscriptions coming in, right? And songs sit there and anyone can listen to anything. And so, for example, the Rolling Stones catalog, they can be pretty sure, and I don't know the number, but they can be pretty sure that it's going to generate this much next month and the next month and the next month. Whereas in the olden days, when you were manufacturing CDs and shipping around the country and convincing record stores to fit things here, and they only had room for this many, it was a lot more volatile. So it's a good time for the record business. The second answer to your question doesn't necessarily mean it's all good news for the mainstream record labels, right? Because the truth is that one of the wonderful things that's happened with this whole digital revolution is that now access to customers is a whole lot easier for all concerned. And a musician in their bedroom can, in principle, make the music themselves, upload it to a place that will then get it to all of these platforms, and they can have direct access to their customers. And we have seen some of that, right? But you remember how important radio was? He was number four. The truth is that you still need to get your music heard. And while some of that can and does happen organically, and TikTok has totally shaken this up, right? But it's taken ages for the record labels to work out what the hell do we do with TikTok? How do we control that? How do we influence that? But the truth is that they work out ways, right? And it might be that it is possible for guys in their bedroom or girls in their bedroom to become a superstar and reach their own audience. It's heavily weighted against the record labels who've got marketing teams and dedicated TikTok teams and budgets, and they find ways to keep some influence.
I have a question just based on that conversation. So with like things like TikTok or like Reels, so you have like those snippets of songs, is TikTok and Facebook paying into the record labels, or are they short enough snippets that they don't have? What's the rules on that?
Great question. Open to much, much debate. yeah. And from the beginning, YouTube, right? YouTube pays almost nothing through, right? It's complicated. Yeah, it's very complicated. Yeah.
I like the whole diagram of the champagne cork.
Thank you. I made that. Yeah, that's a little bit to do with just not wanting to lose a customer and giving them an opportunity to register now their interest, right? Otherwise, you know, 2 weeks later when it actually comes out, you might have forgotten about it, you're listening to something else. But absolutely, yeah, absolutely. Chart position is still hugely important and fought over. Yeah, well, interesting question. Yeah, in terms of subscribers and in terms of money being paid to the record labels and then in turn artists, Spotify's number one. Apple Music is number two. And in some countries, Apple Music's number one. Apple Music's number one in the US, for example, and in various other countries too. But YouTube is where more people listen to music, right? But again, in different formats, in sometimes only little snips. It's complicated.
You get more live, but some of the live stuff is more interesting on YouTube than what it is on the other platforms.
Yep.
By far.
Yep, 100%.
You get recordings that somebody did, you know, in a home version. Like you're talking about somebody sits at home and records. By the way, they do record on Mac equipment, because that was the way to go until Yamaha came out with the O2. But a lot of people are recording live concerts from mixing console with semi-pro equipment, you know, branded by the artist also. You know, we're talking maybe second or third rate, like bluegrass. If you want to see bluegrass, you go to YouTube. You don't go anywhere else. And it sounds good, and it looks good. Because they're, you know, not very dynamic when it comes down to movement and effects.
Yeah.
But it's
great.
Much better on YouTube than any other platform. And, I mean, I would say that's the new frontier is live.
And it's also, exactly.
Live is the frontier. That was my frontier. But
and coming into video games, right? Yeah. You see these in-game events, you know, our kids, you know, it blows their mind, right, when they're playing whatever it might be, you know, Fortnite, and all of a sudden there's a huge, you know, activation, right? It's reaching kids in a brand new way. There. Yes.
That's the interesting part.
Do you think, I mean, you said that Apple's number one in the US, and I think it's because the iPhone is hugely popular in the US versus other countries. For example,
yep. You can get Apple Music for Android. You can. Yeah, you can. It's not as good as the version on iOS. Yeah.
Well, if there are no further questions, thank you very much, Neil.
Thank you for coming.
It's been super interesting.